All right.
Welcome to today's Advent of Code. How's my sound? Is it okay? Let me check. Hello, 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 hello. Hello, 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 hello. I feel like it's a bit. Hello, 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 hello. It's like my settings have changed a little bit, right? Let me sort this out. 1, 2, 3. Hello, hello, hello. Hello, hello, hello. Okay, let me check. Hello, hello, hello. This is better, right? Seems like, sounds a bit better, right? I don't know what happened there. Alright, good. That's what's important, and it sounds good. Alright. Yeah, because I just turned the power off and on my microphone, so... Maybe it had a bad initialization or something, I don't know. Alright, let's also make sure that the color theme... better, right? Just too much. All right, welcome to today's Advent of Code. You also hear that? What is going on today? Something is up with my sound. There's like a buzz. I think we should try and fix this, right? Now it went away, right? No. Okay. This is not a good start to the double feature, right? That's like the main sound, right? Okay. Now it's gone. Okay. This is the problem with sound, right? You can never know why it happens, but yeah. Alright, let's get this rolling. And let's just hope that the sound stays okay. I mean, so what I only thing I did is like I unplug things and plug them back again. I don't know. Alright, so let's go for day 3 of the advent of code. Let me actually pop out the chat here. I'm gonna do that in a new window so I can see what you're saying. Pop out. There you go here. And then. Alright, now we should be good. Alright. So we're on day 3. It's actually day 4 now, but we skipped day 1. It's a bit high. Music is a bit higher than your voice. Okay. That as well. This work was working fine yesterday. I think it's this one. Okay, my knobs don't work. Alright, everything is messed up, but now is better, right? Now it should be fine. Okay. We have a saying in Icelandic, right? It's the same as when it rains, it pours, right? It's like today the whole sound system seems to have been misbehaving. Maybe it's just, yeah. I can put my voice a bit higher as well. Alright. That should be fine. Okay, let's get to the programming and hope that nothing more happens. Because you can test the picture, right? You can see, oh, everything looks good. But then, like, to test the audio, you have to, like, record it, look at it. And because it was working fine, I kind of assumed that it would keep working fine. But alright, let's go for day 3 of the advent of code in Haskell. Oh, actually, I think I have to change the name of the stream, right? Because now we're doing day 3 and 4. Alright, done. Let's get to it. So submarine has been making some odd. So okay, so what we've done so far is that we like scanned the bottom, and then we next up we were like controlling the boat itself. So we're on a submarine to find the keys to the sleigh. Because they were dropped in the ocean or something. So we have to find all the stars and then we can find the sleigh. Alright. So we're supposed to make some... Yeah, okay, so... But submarine's making some odd creaking noises. So you ask it to produce a diagnostic report just in case. The diagnostic report consists of a list of binary numbers which, when decoded properly, can tell you many useful things about... the condition of the submarine. The first parameter to check is the power consumption. You need to use the binary numbers in a diagnostic report to generate two new binary numbers called the gamma rate and the epsilon rate. The power consumption can then be found by multiplying the gamma rate by the epsilon rate. Alright, each bit in the gamma rate can be determined by finding the most common bit in the corresponding position of all the numbers in the diagnostic report. For example, giving the following diagnostic report, considering only bits of the first of each number, there are 5 0 bits and 7 1 bits. Since the most common bit is 1, the first bit of the gamma rate is 1. Alright. So, I think, yeah, okay. I think we'll take this list, we will transpose it, take the sum of the number, and then see if it's see if it's less than half the length of the list. And I assume that that we will always get like an odd number of bits. Okay, let's get to it. So we will take the input and we open up, this is day 2. Now let's open up day 3. And I'm just gonna go ahead and go here, make there day 3. Day 3. Touch day 3.hs. And now we're going to open file. And then we're just gonna open this file in VS Code. Oh, now yeah, we want to open folder, because we wanted to like have all the right paths for the language server, right? Okay, so we say example, we're just gonna do the same as before. Paste our input here. Now we need to increase the size. All right, and here our language server is already helping. Let me just click here. All right, now let's see. Read input. So what we're going to have, okay, it's gonna be a file path. And how are you gonna model this? Okay, it's a list of binary numbers. So, and we're gonna have to end up turning them into binary. So how do we, I think it's data.bits in Haskell. Yes. Okay, we have a way to click at bits. I think I had like a function that was like bits to number or something like that. But let's just make it into a list of bits. So what is a list of bits? Let's just make it a list of bools to start with, right? Input equals, okay, so it's gonna be read file. And then we are going to map over the line. So now it's crackling again. So what I did between last time and now is that I like unplugged my sound processor and I replugged it in, and then now like the whole system seems to be in a big mess. I don't know. Hello, hello, hello? Yeah. Okay, there's no cracking right now, right? Okay, let's see. Read at okay, how are we gonna read these numbers? Let's just say read num. So read num is going to take a string and it's going to return us a list of bools. So read num of empty is going to be empty. Read num of 1 rest is going to be read num equals map read 1, where read 1 0 is false, and if it's anything else it's going to be true. Map read 1, so we're gonna map read num over the... We're gonna map this over the lines, right? And this is actually gonna be IO. And now it's complaining that there's a redundant bracket. Alright, this is gonna be a list of listables, of course, right? Because it's gonna return a list. Now it's complaining that it's a list of listables. Oh yeah, okay. I think we do map read num like this. Right, we have to fmap this. Alright, like this. And let's see. GTI day 3. Now, we are gonna go in is read input example. Okay, and now we have the input ready. Each bit in the gamma ray can be determined by finding the most common bit in the corresponding position. So what I'm thinking is like if we do transpose of imp, maybe I have to do particular list, and we like transpose it. So now then we have like it will be a list of all the first bits, a list of all the second bits, and so on, right? And map sum, right? No instance for num bool. So let's actually just have this be ints, right? This is gonna be 0 and this is gonna be 1. And we're gonna have this to be a map list of ones. And then we reload and we run it again. 75875. Considering only bits of each number, there are 5 10 bits and 7 1 bits. Yeah, okay, so we take we also need to know how many, right? So task 1 is going to take a list of ints and give us a list of ints. A list of bool, actually. Right. Task 1. So it will, we will do in, okay. This is gonna be equal to something, right? And we're gonna say where tint is transpose of int, and we are going transpose. Okay, so we're gonna map over it, right? So we're gonna. So, the check bit is going to be, so this is like the list, one, so let's just imagine we're looking at the first digit, right? Or let's just say digit here, and we say check bit digit is equal to, sum of bit, less than equal to length of bit. So, considering only the 5 bits of each number, the 5, your first bit of the gamma rate is 1. This is digit. This is digit. And we have to import data.list here. Okay, now we're gonna say map check bit digit. No, map check bit in. Okay, so this is not the final one, right? But we need to. Okay, so task 1 in. Right, in, let's read the input again. Ooh. It's giving us true for all of them. What was the input here? Right, okay, wait, so... Well, we're getting too many trues, right? Alright, we have to map check with temp. Exactly. Let's relearn it again. And we run it. The most common second bit of the numbers in the deterministic report is 0. Okay, so let's look at the transpose imp. Why is the audio like this? That's the worst, right? If you have bad audio. Let me pause the music a bit. Hello, hello? My phone, right? I'll keep it somewhere else in case. Yeah. Half of length of digit. Oh, yeah, that's true. We forgot to divide this by 2. That's good. Because you want to find the most common one, right? So 0. Yeah, but I think it's the opposite, right? It's going to be larger than or equal to. Let's put the Christmas music back on. Yeah, I'll fix the audio right after this. This is... Yeah, because it's been fine for like months now. Let's actually just do this. True, false, true, true, false, right? And that's the gamma rate. 10110, and then we say set bit. So I think we need like a list of bools to int. To int. Bin to int. Okay, and that's the type. Bin to int. We can like what we do here is that we say, I think we say like index or something. So we can take the set bit I with the S value set and all others is clear. So a int. Wait, let me... There was like a nice way to do this, I think. Wait. Okay, so what we're gonna do is that we're gonna say bit bin to int. So okay, let's import data.bits, right? Data.bits. And we say set bit to. And we say 0 bits, right? Now let's do this at an int. And then we get 3. Why do we get 3? I thought we would get like 2. two. So we set one. We set bit three. This is weird, right? We should be getting... If I set the second bit, I should be getting two. Right? Okay, let's just do it the other way. We can take the bools. Okay, so we just do this manually, right? So we sip like 1 or 0 to infinity. Ins, we sip 0 with the bools. Okay, then we filter on second, right? So we filter the ones that are true. So let's show this here. Filter second, sip, like false, true, true. Then we get 1 true and 2 true, right? But we're gonna reverse the bools. And then we filter on second, and then we map first. And then we map 2 to the power. I think it's like this. No, maybe it's 2 to the power, right? And then 2 to the power of 5, 32. So we just sum it up, right? Bin into bools is this, and then we can just merge these right away. Okay, and then we just do period, and we don't need these. We do period. Now what's wrong with this? Alright, we want to sum. Let's reload it. Bin to int. So we're saying like true, true, false. And this should be 2 plus 4, 6. Nice. Who needs to figure out the library when we can just do this? Okay, I'm gonna map check bin to temp, and then we int here, and we're gonna say bin to int of this. Okay, now we're gonna reload, and we go all the way up and 22. Okay, that was what we were supposed to get for this one. So that's the gamma rate. The epsilon rate gathered in similarly, rather than use the most common bit, the least common bit is used. Yes. Okay, so we say check bit digit. This is like gamma digit, and then we have eps digit. Is equal to, it's gonna be the same, right? Except we reverse this here. And I think like it will never be equal, right? Because maybe we need to have it less than here, actually. Let's see what map eps gives for task 1. That gives 9. Yeah. Okay. So it's gonna be 9 times 22. Now we don't actually need calculate the sum twice, right? So let's We just we map the sum over it. Okay, map sum over the tinp, and then right. Because we transpose and we map the sums over it, we get like the how many there are, and then we. Okay, so sums is equal to map sum tint, and then gamma digit. So gamma, this is gonna be gamma s for the sum. So this is just like, oh yeah, no, we need the length, right? But they're all gonna be the same, right? So length is gonna be the yeah, sorry, my audio is very bad today. I don't know why. But it is the worst. Actually, let's just not bother. Right? Let's just do both here. We'll see if it bites us before the end of this, right? So, bin to int map gamma tint times bin to int map eps like this. 198, yes. Let's just see if this is good enough, right? Because it's quite, I don't think it should be too bad, at least not for the first one, right? So the here it's gonna be 1,000 that we're gonna do. Let's see. Okay, pretty fast, right? So we didn't need to optimize it, because let's see if it's wrong, we might have to check something. Okay, we got the first one. Let me check. Yeah, it's like a slight, like down there, right? At least in my headphones. Yeah, this is very, so I had this fixed, right? And then I turned off the thing for my revisit, and then, yeah. All right, I say, so let's finish part two, and then we take a break, and then meanwhile, I will fix the audio, because this is, yeah, not good enough. Okay. Alright, next you should verify the life support rating, which can be multiplying the oxygen generator. Scrub rating of values that can be found in your diagnostic report. Finding them is the tricky part. Both values allocated using signal processors involves filtering out values until only one remains. Before searching for either rating value, start with a full list of binary numbers from the diagnostic report. We check the first bit. Okay, so bit criteria. Keep only numbers selected by the bit criteria for the type of rating value which you are searching. Discard numbers which do not match the bit criteria. You only have one number left? Stop. This is, oh, okay, so we're not doing the first, just the first bit. Oh. Okay, so we, Okay, I'm not quite. This seems like very needlessly complicated. Okay, so I think we. Okay, so we. So we look. We take the 12 numbers and we consider the first bit in each number. Or one more bit since 7 is 0. So we keep only 7 with the 1 with the first precision. Then consider the second bit of the 7 remaining numbers. There are more 0 bits than first bits, so keep only the 4 numbers. Okay, actually, I'm gonna take a break now. Like, I have to try and fix the audio. This is. Too bad. Okay. Let me just give me 5 minutes. And I'm gonna mute the audio. Okay, so I just turned it off and on again. Let's see if it like slowly builds up or not. Wait. Because now there's no hiss at all, right? Alright, let's hope this works for a few minutes at least. I'm like super guarded. Yeah, there's something weird going on with the power. Okay, so we're looking at the criteria of the numbers. So we start with all 12 numbers on the first bit. And we have one with the first bit in the first position. Okay. Then consider the second bit of the 7 numbers. There are 4 more bits. Then 1 bit, so keep only the 4 numbers with a 0 bit in the second position. Okay, as there is only 1 number, okay, so find the oxygen. Okay, so we consider the 1 second bit of the 7 remaining ingredients. There are more 0 bits and 1 bits. So keep only the 4 numbers with a 0 bit in the second position. In the third position, 3 of the 4 numbers have a 1, so keep those 3. In the fourth, the 4 numbers have a 1, so keep those 2. In the fifth, there are nickel numbers, 0 bits and 1 bits, 1 each. Oh, okay. Okay, we can't like, yeah, okay. And let's do it. Let's just do it. So what we can do is we can say task 2 and list the list of ints to int. Okay, so we have the input. Okay, and we're gonna recursively check the bit positions. Okay. Yeah, this is like, this would be very easy. We had like indexes and we could just use those. But we don't. It's a bit messy to do. Okay. We can kind of use task one. Okay, let's just encode it, right? So the well, this is the gamma of digit, right? And the AEPs of digit. So we're gonna use those because they figure out like which one is the most common, right? Except we have to have this like larger and then little larger than equal to, because now we don't have an odd number of things. Okay, so task two of input. Right, okay, so we're actually gonna say int is gonna consist of the one n and then the rest. Okay, and then we're gonna say where ints equals sip 0 to, so the indexes are just gonna be 0 to length of n minus 1, right? Length of 1, 2, 3. Yeah, so we want to go like this. Okay, this is gonna be the indices of the that we're looking at currently, right? Okay, then we are going to say but like I don't think we need to keep the numbers around, right? We can just kind of figure out that the first one is 1. And then we find all the most common bits. So, because like it says, yeah, the most common bit in the first one is 1, right? And then in the second one, the most common one is 0. And then the most common one is 1. But we need to, we need to filter them out. Okay, this seems a bit messy. Okay, but let's just do it. Okay, where is gonna equal to some underscore. Now let's just do task to prime, and now we're just gonna iterate over the cur imp, and we're gonna map over the ins. So we're gonna, so we don't have any. If we have, we don't have any, if we have one left, I, it's gonna be I. One. Then we say the one left. Last one is gonna be less one. Okay, we shouldn't end up with no. Okay, now these are the ins. We're just gonna return the current. Okay, and now if we have an I and then the rest of the I's, we are going to say so where xi is equal to, so yeah, so extracting the i's bit. Extract I is going to be map bang bang I over the current. Okay, so we are going to so cur bits. Now most common is going to equal the most common is going to equal the sum of qubits. So the sum of the current bits is larger than the length of qubits div 2, then it's 1, right? And it's true, right? Otherwise it is false. Or yeah, so least common, I think it's like this. Okay, so we have the most common and the least common. Okay, then new int will be equal to so we're gonna filter on the current int on the fact that bang bang I okay, so we're gonna we're filtering the current int. Okay, and this is just gonna be x, so that it's int. So it's element, right? So if the el okay, so let's say it just pulled to a b2 int is equal to a b2 int of true is equal to 1, b2 int false is equal to 0. So the element at the ith position is equal to the b2 int of the most common the current int. That's the new int. And we're gonna do this for all the things. So it's task 2 prime of the new int i's. Now let's actually trace show id over this, right? To see how it works. All right, so task 2, it's going to be task 2 prime imp ins. Let's see, and this is not okay because yeah, we want, but we want to return a list of ints. Or list of ints. Okay, let's just see what happens, right? We just wanna. Well, right, this is task one, but task two. So it gives us 10110. Okay, let's see, trace show in. Where are the qubits here? Oh, we need to load. So the current pairs are 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0. Okay, so that, those were the current bits. Yes. Okay. Okay. So that was those were the ones. Okay, and then the next ones are going to be. So we're supposed to see a 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1. Okay. And then we consider the third bit, and then we get. So we're supposed to see 1, 1, 1, 0. Yeah, okay, with these, and we discard, then we're supposed to see 1, 1, and 0. Yes, and then we're supposed to see 0 and 1, and we see that. Okay, so we, but we, why do we end up with the, okay, I think we mixed up the less than or equals to, so this would be like this. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, okay, I think this is... Okay, so we get the... Then we get to the 10110 and 10111. And then we have 0 and 1. And then what is the most common? Let's always ratio ID of that. And let's see. Reload. The most common answer is true, and the most common is false, and the most common is true, and the most common is supposed to prefer false. Keep the number with a 1. Okay, yeah. Okay, so if 0 and 1 are equally common, keep values with 1 in the position being considered. Okay, so no, but why? So now that. Okay, so it keeps. And then we see the 11110. And oh, now, but it, now it's keeping the some other ones. Okay, I think we have like a... Okay, at least we're iterating over them correctly, right? It's just that this... to keep... Okay, let's say not most common. Let's just say let's just count the ones, right? For the num 0, okay, so the num 1 is going to be the sum of cur. It's right. Then zero is going to be length of cur bits minus sum of cur bits minus the number of ones, right? So num one. So the most common is if num one larger than or equal to num zero. Then 1 else 0. And what's wrong with this? Right, and then we are doing like b2 int on it, so we don't need it. Okay. Least common is equal to. Okay, let's just wait with this least comment. We don't need it now. Okay, now we end up with the right number, right? Okay, so most common, we end up with a 1. Otherwise, yeah. Okay, so let's actually have another kind of... And I have another case here, task 2 prime of the last one. So if there's no one left, then we just return the last one. Otherwise, we're not going to have that case. Okay, so we're just going to say like this. And, okay. So that's the oxygen generator rating. And then we keep the least common number. And if 0, 1 are equal to common, we give the last with a 0 in it. So let's just call this one task to MC. Task to MC. Let's return like this too. And it's gonna be task to MC. Task to LC prime int, where this task to MC. Okay, there's no prime here. MC, and then we're gonna have LC. And hello? We're having another audio glitch. Let's hope it doesn't last. Okay, we don't need to print these anymore, and we're not gonna print the new input anymore. And now this should be fine. We don't even need this function anymore. Let's just copy this. And we say LC here. LC, and we sum, and we say least common. And then we say least common. And then we say, so if the number of ones is larger than or equals to the number of zeros, then we should keep the zeros, otherwise we should keep the ones. We reload, run it, so we get the 101111 and 00111. Is that the one we were supposed to get? Okay, no, this was the... Damn it. So if the number of zeros is less than or equal to the number of ones, I mean, this should be the same result, right? Okay, what's going on here now? Okay, let's map the current inputs again. Trace, show ID. Because now we kind of made it into like as simple as possible, right? This one is not good. Oh yeah, no, sorry. We were just doing the... We weren't recurring correctly. 0, 1, 0, 1, 0. Yeah. Right. So let's remove the trace show ID here. And reload and run it. So now we get the two right numbers. And then this is running on the input. And... Int. I guess we're supposed to multiply them together as per usual. Right. And this is supposed to be, we get an int out of this. Right. And this one gives. Right. So we say int to bool true equals, no, 1 equals true, int to bool 0 equals false. So we go map bin to int, int to bool. Map into bool, and we take the product of this list. And this one doesn't work because product. Okay, so we get 230 for the example. Now, what? Use a binary object diagnostic to calculate the oxygen generator and then multiply the gain. What's the last support? Okay, let's run on the input. 587895. All right, we got it. The audio seems to be holding up, but I really need to make sure that it does that. Well, all right, we completed day 3. I don't think we're gonna look into the core now. I mean, like, we did it also by, I don't know. It's not like we did it in a cool way. It's like we just brute forced it. But I think, you know, for days 1, 2, and 3, right, it's like, you know, you can just solve them pretty fast, right? You don't really need to dig into it and find a super nice way to do it, right? And I think, like, the way we did it now was that we, you know, it's like, it's pretty clear that it was doing the right thing. Like, when we just swapped to this way, right, the other one was kind of a bit murky. And you could probably change these into like maps and like remove some of the intermediates, but yeah, I think this solution is fine, right? I would accept this if someone handed it in. All right, let's take a 1 minute break or 5 minute break. Or no, not 5 minutes, 2 minute break. I'm just gonna stand up, shake my legs, and then we'll continue with day 4. Alright, see you in 2 minutes. And wait, yeah. All right. Let me. All right, we're back. Doesn't sound like there are any audio issues. but we'll be on the guard. All right, let's look at day 4. Let's see how we do. Let me open up a new file. We're just gonna do it in the same directory because it all happened on the same day. Now, maybe this one is gonna be hard. We don't know. All right, we're almost 1.5 kilometers below the surface. Already so deep that you can't see any sunlight, but you can see, however, a row. A giant squid that has attached itself to the outside of your submarine. Maybe it wants to play bingo. Okay. It's a bit of an assumption, but I guess. Bingo is placed on a set of board, each consisting of 5x5 grid of numbers. Numbers are chosen at random, and the chosen number is marked on all boards on which it appears. Numbers may not appear on all boards. Okay. If all numbers in any row or any column of a board are marked, that board wins. Okay, this is going to be interesting. The submarine has a bingo subsystem. Okay. That's good. Good for a submarine. It automatically generates a random order in which to draw numbers in a random set of boards, for example. Okay, we get bingo numbers, and then after the first 5 numbers are drawn, there are no winners, but the boards are marked as follows. Okay, after the next 6 numbers are drawn, yeah, okay, so we mark the board. 124 is drawn. And the third board wins because it has at least one complete row or column of marked numbers. In this case, the entire top row is marked. 14, yeah. Bingo! The score of the winning board can now be calculated. Start by finding the sum of all unmarked numbers. Unmarked numbers in that board. In this case, the sum is 188. Then multiply that sum by the... Wow, okay, we're playing bingo. And then we're gonna... So it was just called when the board won 24 to get the final score. To guarantee victory against the giant squid, figure out which board will win first. Okay, so we don't need to keep the... So it's just... Diagonals don't count, right? So we just need to check these and these. For set memberships. Okay, so how do we do this? First we generate the sets, right? First we have to parse this, right? So let's put this into example. All right, now I have to say example day 4. Okay, and this is gonna be this one. I think this one's gonna be fun. Okay, so we're gonna parse the... So let's say data input. So it's gonna be the input is gonna be the nums called. So the input is just going to be imp, and it's going to have the numbers called, and it's going to have the list of all the boards, right? Which is going to be a list of lists, right? Now, okay, we don't actually need this. Okay. So let's just write here a rate input file path goes to a top couple of these. Okay, and we're gonna say here, let's just say, you know, type board is equal to a list of ints, and then this is a list of board. Read input. Let's import the parsec. So let's say data input is going to be, yeah, it's going to be an input of the nums of int, and then it's going to be a list of boards. And now we're going to say this is going to be just to input, and we're going to define a reader. So we're going to say instant read input, where read s reads prec whatever is equal to so we're gonna import text as parsec compromiser, import text parsec, no, text inter parse, let's just write like read p to s to press, yeah, and then we import that, right? And then read input is just equal to read right string, and then so this is going to be read input over read file. So fmap right, so it's like this. But what is wrong with this one? Couldn't match expected type read sp reads prec. Alright, so read input. No, so parse input is gonna be a read p input. And this is gonna be parse input. Right? Right, and then parse input. Well, like this. Okay, now read input is gonna be, what's wrong with that? Yeah, this is gonna be IO input, exactly. Okay, yeah, I mean, the parsing is hard for this one, right? Hello, Level Wyverns, and welcome to the stream. Hope you're enjoying the Haskell. Now we're actually doing, now we're doing a fun part, right? The parsing. Wow. Thanks for the follow. It's always nice to get some follows. Right, okay. So, we're going to read the first line, and then skip one line, and then read 5 lines, and then skip a line. Okay, let's may I ask why Haskell? Because it is the best language. It's got the type system, and it's got a very mature ecosystem, right? You have packages for almost everything, and it's functional, so you can do a lot of stuff. That's why. I don't really have a better reason. Let's see, data nums called is gonna be nums called the list of ints, and then we're gonna say instance read nums called where reads prec underscore equals read p to s of so we can actually put this here, right? And here we're gonna say parse. We're gonna just say parse here. Where parse that read p nums called. So this is gonna be the initial list. Right? So parse is gonna be do. And then we're gonna go to the page for the text parser commenters. Yeah, thanks. It's actually, it's very nice. It's from var Milo. And it's the Icelandic flag, which is a nice flag. Right. Text parser combinators read p. Okay, so we are going to say sep by parses zero or more occurrences of p separated by sep. So right. So we are going to say here is the list is going to be the n. So this is going to be sep by. Yeah, I'm just going to import everything from this library. I don't need this. So this is going to be sep by. So this is going to be nums. This is going to be actually. It's just going to be nums called mapped over sep by. So which is it? Sep by p sep parses zero more occurrences of p separated by sep. And it's going to be reads prec. And then we just say n at int separated by why is it combining now? Right, so we now need to say read p to s. No, read s to p, right? And then this is going to be reads. What's complaining about here? Can I apply read as to invisible? Read spec n. And it's going to be separated by, and it's going to be separated by the char comma. Now this is going to be undefined, so we're just going to be able to load this, right? Now load day 4. Let's actually quit this and just say day 4.hs. Now we're going to say read at nums called. Oh, we're going to actually have to set x type applications, and we're going to read at nums called and then what does it say? It says 7495, right? 7, 4, 9, 5. Right. We have to reload. Right, so it works for the... Yeah, exactly. So then we fmap directly over whatever we get, right? And so, because we're just going to read a list, right? And then we're just going to make it into our nums called. And this is just to make it nums called. All right, so first here. So the input is going to be nums called, right? And then a list of words. Okay, so we're going to say here, do. So we are going to we are going to read a nums called, right? So parse nums called. And we're going to use this parsing function again. So we actually want it to be global instead of having to do read p to s to p something. Parse nums called. Okay, so what do we do here? We say do nums is going to be parse nums called. So that's the first one. And then we say, and we return input nums undefined. And then we deriving show here, right? Let's just return an empty list for now. Okay, yes. Can we say int? We do like this and like this. And we're never gonna have precedence here, so it doesn't matter. Okay, then we reload and let's see, we read nums call still. But now we're gonna read at input 74945. And then slash n. How do I set m, right? There's like a way to ghgi multi-line, something like that. Multi-line input. We just have to set plus m, okay. Set plus m. So read at input, and we're gonna say 754. Space. Oh, okay. Return 54. Then, oh no. Okay, I don't think this works actually. So let's just say example day 4. Okay, let's just parse example day 4 right away. Actually, we roll this. GTI day 4. And let's say read at input over read file. Example day 4. Set x type application so they allow us to do it. Read no parse. It's probably because we have more stuff. But if we remove all this, it should work, right? Yeah. So then we read the nums called. Okay, now what we will have is that we say, okay, now we say skip spaces. And then we should be able to parse this file. Nice. Okay, now we're gonna put in the board back. And we are going to say, we're gonna say sep by, right, okay, so parse board. So how do we parse a board? We don't actually need to read instance for nums called here. How do you say parse board? Read p board. Parse board is going to be do. We're gonna have a parsing of lines where parse line is undefined, but we are going to say sep by char slash n parse line. right? I think that should be okay. No, it's actually let's wait, right? Parse line and yeah, and board is just like literally this, right? So board. And parse line is just gonna be read p of int. No, it's actually just gonna be read p of int. And this is gonna be data board deriving show. Now parse line. How do we parse a line? Well, it is sep by read s to p of reads prec of 10 highest presidents set by, and then what are they separated by? They are separated by spaces and I think this one is good, okay? And then we say B is parse board. Let's just go with one board for now. Okay, we parse the first board. Sorry, my... Pretty nice, right? You just kind of parse and then you assume. Okay, and this is our board. Yeah. Okay, now we have to parse all the boards. So we say boards sep by. So we parse a board. And they are going to be separated by a char slash n. Or no, string. Like, there's going to be a slash n and then space and then slash n, right? I think this should work. Let's see. Ambiguous parse. Oof, I don't know how to deal with that. Set by one. Ambiguous parse. So what if I do just B? No, wait, I can do set by parse board. Skip spaces. Right, that should be possible. Wait, it's not. Okay, it loops. Set by one in parse board, maybe. Yeah, that is a good idea. No, I think the skip spaces here is too much. String slash n space slash n. Ambiguous parse again. What about? Separated and ended by sep. Okay. We're almost there, right? We managed to like, if we know the amount of boards, we're fine. And we can step right, so What if I just write a loop? Is that too much? Yeah, it's probably not gonna be as fast. Maybe it's separated by session. So what if I change this to end by? Because they are ended by one of those, right? So and then we have this as slash end. No parse, okay. But what if we go back to this one? Let me just see if we're still good. B parse board. No, okay, then this is too bad. Okay. What if I do, like, parse board, skip spaces. Well, this one returns what? Yeah, okay. Like this. And B. And B, skip spaces. Skip spaces and return B. That's allowed. Ambiguous parse A. P1B is equal to this. P1. So we're gonna say B's is many P1B. Because it doesn't tell you like why it's ambiguous, right? Which is a bit annoying. Okay, and then what if we say many okay, I'm gonna try again by saying this and then EOF and then return boards. Maybe that will maybe that will be enough to make it. No. Maybe it doesn't realize that it has to be exactly a 5 lines. So let's change this. So this is count. This is count 5, right? And then parse line. L. There is like a way to do this without with some combinators, but I don't know. Skip spaces. Return L. Right, okay, and now we're gonna say count 5, and then now we're no longer doing this. And now let's go back to our testing board. B is a error board. And then it should know that it should be only, should be 5 numbers. Damn it. Oh yeah, we didn't change the file. Okay, this one works. So parse board is count 5 parse line, okay? The parse line, that's exactly going to be count 5, and then this into skip spaces, return N. Okay, this one works. Now, what about this? All right, this is return N. Okay, now it at least managed to get the one board. Now let's undo this. No parse. Damn it. Okay. Many parse board. B over 2 skip spaces. All right, we parsed all the boards by this pattern here, which means like do it and then skip spaces and then return fun. So we kind of specifically specify the numbers, move brackets. Let's encapsulate this pattern, right? With skip is equal, so P, this is equal to P into R, or like res, and then skip spaces. Return P. Okay. So we can just say many with oh wait, this should be something over. So parse board and then result and then skip spaces and then return return R. All right. And then just many with skip parse board, and I'm sure this combinator is called something, right? I just can't remember now. With skip parse line, and then we just say with skip. Oh, line 31. Oh, like this. All right, we did it quite nicely, right? Do I need the EOF here? No. Okay, and then we can also say input nums over this. We can probably do some applicative stuff here as well, but this is fine, right? Wait, this is actually... like this. Okay, it's quite smooth. Isn't there like a nice... there's a nice pattern here, right? I think it's like... input over... with like with skip and then like the applicative thing and then this. And then... no, yeah, right. I think it's like this. Nice. See, it's all applicative. Wow. Completely unreadable, though. But... very nice. Okay, this is Haskell. Making things... wine liners. After everything else, we kind of screwed up. Okay. We don't need the nums called anymore, right? It's just actually... it's just going to be... just events. Okay, and the board... yeah, we're gonna have the board still. Okay, I think we can move this as well. Yeah, I think this is like getting very unreadable, right? Okay, but now we are getting... okay, now we have the numbers called and the boards, right? Okay, that was the parsing, which Haskell is super good at, right? So now we have to do the actual task. Alright, let me see. Okay, this is the previous one, database, we don't need that. We don't need the parser anymore. After 5, there are no winners, but the boards are marked as follows. Okay. Okay, so let's import data.set. Import data.set. Now, we want to say board sets is equal to... takes a board and returns a list of set. Or actually, set of int. Board sets. And it's map to set. I think it's, let's say, Google data.set. Now we're getting into some hardcore stuff. From distinct, so we can just say from list, yeah. Okay, map, so this is going to be a board and else, right? And so it's going to be map from list to else. Plus map from list to transpose else. So then we have like the lines and the columns. And we're gonna have from list. what you complaining about now, Right. Now it's complaining about, import dataset set, and then import qualified data.set as set. Okay, set dot from list, and then we have the same here. Set from list and set dot from list, and mother bracket still what? Redundant bracket. Okay. Right, and we need this one from data dot list. Okay. So let's read the input. So we have imper. Okay. Let's do it differently. Let's see input called and boards. Now we say boards. Let's get the first board, right? Boards. Or no, let's actually have all the boards, sorry. Boards at, and then we have one board. Okay, this is a board, and we have board to set. Oh, we haven't reloaded. Board to set. Board sets, it's called. A board. Okay, so this is like the set of numbers it has, right? So, we close the actual challenge, I think. Yeah. Okay, so this is like the first. So 11, 13, 17, 22. So 11, 13, 17, 22, and 0. So these are all the sets. And then we have the 1, 6, 8, 21, 22, which is this set, right? And, right. Okay, and so basically, we have bingo once every element. So once this set is contained in the set of elements that have been called so far. Okay. So what we will do is we will write has bingo. We go to board to set of int. Actually, we don't need, so the board doesn't need to be a list of ints. It can be a set of int. And then when we parse a board, we actually say we count 5 over so this is gonna be board dot board sets. And has a bingo board to pool. And bingo equals false. That's just has bingo. So this one is cannot match or read P actual P. Right, and so this is gonna be board a proper port. Why is this not enough? So board is a set, takes a set of the board sets, right? So this one takes a list of ints to Right, and then we can see a board, and it's just these sets, right? Because we don't actually need to know the structure, we just need the sets. So Has Bingo is going to take a board, and it's going to take a set of ints that has been called. And maybe it should just be a list of, yeah, maybe we can just avoid this. We can just have this is a list of sets of ints. So this is gonna be the list of set of ints, and then this is also, I mean, it is a set of ints, but we're gonna iterate through it like a list, so we might as well just be a list. Okay, and this is not needed. Okay, and so we're gonna say has a board. So okay, board sets, and then so far, so what we compute is we say any all called sets, right, where all called so any takes a to bool and a list of a's, and so it's gonna be one of all the sets. So all called set is going to be, so here we check that the set minus so far, right? So by if we remove everything in so far from the set, then it should, so this should be set difference. I think that maybe it's like this. Set dot minus, what is it called? Set difference. Let's see. Data dot set. Yeah, it's /. Set dot. Okay. Any. Could match. Any. Yeah. Okay. So we check. Is empty, right? Let's see. What is happening right now? Alright. Nothing important. Okay. Okay, so let's just do is proper subset of, exactly. So that's what we want to check. So is proper subset of we just want to check is subset of. Yeah, so null S1 difference S2, exactly. So S1 is a subset of S2. So it's gonna be this is gonna be flip set dot is subset of. And now it's still complaining because all called flip is says, oh, what do you, yeah, okay, like this. Okay, so has bingo. Right, so it was the third one that had the bingo. So let's just get all the boards, right? So it's gonna be B1, B2, B3. So B3 was the one with the bingo when 7, 4, 9, 5, 11, 17, 23, 21. So 24, okay, so Yeah, so it's these numbers. So n's equals these numbers. Now n's. Okay, we check. Has bingo. Let's check just b1, right? Set dot from list ns. Is plus lighter 2, but it's type board. Oh, yeah, origin reload, sorry. Okay, and then we rerun the board and we rerun the ns. Now we say has bingo b1. Okay, b1, no. B2, no. B3, true. Exactly, but if we said not, we'd remove the 94, then this is false. Okay. So we got the has bingo function. In this case, the entire drop row score of the learning board can be considered for finding the sum of all unmarked numbers on that board. So what is the sum of all unmarked numbers on that board? Okay, so let's try turn this into like maybe int. So it's gonna be the MB win. Okay, maybe win bingo. We're gonna say, okay, if any all call sets, then, okay, now we're gonna take the union, the set, okay, the set dot unions of sets. Okay, and then we are going to remove set dot remove so far. Okay, and then we should have a set of the numbers that have not been called. And let's calculate the sum of that. And just turn it to a list, and then we do the sum of the list. Let's say reload this and we define the b1, b2, b3, and we say has bingo b3 would, okay, mb win bingo B3 set. So that's just 188, and then we multiply it by the last number, 24. Okay, so now I think we have our game plan, right? We're gonna like iterate through it, the sets, and then we are going to. So we're gonna have like the set of numbers that have currently been called, and we're always gonna like add one number to it. We are going to check if any of the boards have a maybe win. If it has a maybe win, then we return it. Okay, so task one takes in file path and returns an int. Okay, so task one. Int. Okay, so first, where input nums boards is equal to what did we say? Read at input. This is an IO int. So do input nums boards read at input. Fmapped over read file int. Okay, and then we are going to... So task one prime is gonna take in... Okay, so it's gonna have a couple of things, right? It's gonna have the so far. It's gonna have the boards. And it's going to have like the... So if it's done, then we return error, no winner ever. Okay, but task one. So nums so far boards NNS. Okay, so then we are going to say so this is where, so NSF num so far prime is equal to we're gonna insert the new one into the set, right? Set dot insert n num so far. Okay, and then we are going to map. So this is a list of boards, so we're gonna map. We're gonna flip these arguments. Just to make it a bit easier to map it. Okay, so we map. Thank you, Matt314. Seems like you're a big Pi fan. Should probably watch those kilos. Anyway, pies are good, and pie is good. Let me see. Ooh, okay, so we're gonna... I think it was like a map maybe. Let's just map maybe. Isn't there like a function that's like a Hugo? You know, you have like an A, and you get a maybe B, and then you get a list of A's, and you get a maybe B out. First, just did a list extra. Oof. We're just gonna map maybes, y'all. Okay. Res equals map maybe. And we're gonna map MB win bingo and NSF prime over the boards. Okay, and now we're actually just gonna do this in a case statement. And also teaching Haskell at uni. Yeah. I mean, these are fun exercises for if you're teaching, right? Case map maybe MB waking boards of. Now, if we have a winner, we return winner times n. Otherwise, we are going to go task one prime with NSF prime and the boards and NS. And now we're just gonna call task one prime on a return task one prime on a we're just gonna grab the first number actually, because it's never gonna be, you know, you can't win a bingo with just one number, so it's gonna be fine. Set.singleton. Ah, okay, we can actually just, we don't need to worry about it. So just, let's just say, this is a... So far is gonna be set.empty. The boards are gonna be the boards. And the numbers is gonna be nums. No, this is set.insert nums so far. And I think we need to import data.maybe. So let's see. Task one on example. Exception prelude, no parse. Oh no. But we've been parsing it, right? All right, it's example day four. Sorry. Example day four. 4512. Which is exactly the answer. To guarantee a victory against the Giants Kid, figure out which board will win first. What will be your final score if you choose that board? Yeah, so this is just we calculated and we, you know, we find the first one. And yeah, so we should be able to do this puzzle at this point. Okay, now I hope this is just a long list. So, okay, input, day four. Now, because this is like a bunch of set manipulations, I'm going to say main IO and then main equals task one, input day four into print. And I'm going to actually GHC03 on day four that it just... Oh no. Why does it? Oh, right. Because it's not called module main. Sorry. We do it. And then we run it. 35670. In 25 milliseconds. Let's see if it's correct. We got it. So we had a lot of fun parsing. Why is it complaining about this one? Yeah, okay, we're not gonna use a new type because I don't think we can. Oh, right, we're not actually defining an instance here. New type? Okay, that's fine. So we did part one, so it's all about parsing. We ended up with a nice applicative parser. And we did this set list union thing. 25 milliseconds is pretty nice, right? And I would like to point out that in other languages, I think this whole parsing business takes a long time. And like these just set manipulation things, this is not a lot of code, right? I think Haskell has the win here. But, I don't know, we could also do this, like, somehow differently, right? We don't need this if then else. Alright, but let's check out task 2. Okay, so on the other hand, it might be wise to try a different strategy. Let this giant squid win. Okay, so we aren't sure how many bingo boards the giant squid played at one time, so... Rather than waste the time counting its arms, the safe thing to do is to figure out which word will win last and choose that one. In the above example, the second board is the last to win, which happens after 13 is eventually called and its middle column is completely marked. If you were to keep playing until this point, the second board would have a sum of unmarked numbers equal to 148 for a final score of 148, 13, 19, 24. Figure out which board will win last. Once it wins, what would its final score be? Okay, yeah, so now instead of just stopping, we should keep going. So we just copy paste task two. I mean, the inputs are the same. Okay, task two prime. But now we want to kind of keep track of the boards that have one and the ones that have not one. Done. One, and then the rest of the boards. One. Okay, right, so if there's no winner ever, that's one case, right? But probably not gonna end up with that case, so we're just gonna kind of ignore it. Okay, so if we have the last one, ooh, right. So I think we need to check the case for the last one at the end, right? So we can't do it here because we need the end, right? We need the number for the final number, that's called. So here, num so far. Okay, so we calculate the new num so far, and we calculate new boards is going to be filter, so newly won. So like multiple might win at the same time, right? We see this and we go sometimes. So the filter is just right, so I think it's called span, like the function that you split things into, yeah, things that where it works, but it's not span, right? It's because span is the returns the first element that wins. What is it called again? A to bool, list of A's, A, partition. Nice. So newly won, not yet, is going to be partition. Right. No, we don't actually have to do this, right? Because we will have, yes. Yeah, we need to do this, but sorry. So we can have here task 2 prime so far, one, and then like the last board. And then we have the nums so far. This will be like, okay, so we're gonna actually, we're gonna use this one again. So then we gotta keep playing the game until it's done. So we're gonna do it like this. Yeah, task 1 prime. So we have only one board. We have bees and board nums, right? So this is gonna be task 1 prime of so far BS nums. Right, because then we kind of want to keep playing, and we know it will be the board that wins, but we just keep playing. And I mean, we're using map, maybe, blah blah, but yeah, it will fuse, is what we're hoping. Like, it'll be list fusion, and it'll be super fast anyway. Okay, so newly won, not yet, is partition is just $MB. Win bingo NSF prime map NSF prime over boards. Now we need to import is just from data dot maybe. We need to import partition from data dot list, and it doesn't like this because partition blocked with too few arguments is just okay. Yeah, okay, we're not, yeah, okay, we do mapping like this. He's just ambiwind bingo overboards. And, okay, this one is going to be a task to prime. NSF prime, one plus plus newly. We don't have to keep track of the ones that win. They don't actually matter. So this is just filter. NS prime num so far. Not yet. There's nothing wrong. And the ones that don't want so far don't matter. Oh no. Let's run task 2 on example day 4. Let's see what happens. 1924, it returns, which is the expected output for the example. So let's check what happens if we say input day 4. Boom, 36 milliseconds. Is it the right answer though? Yes. All right. We did it. We did both days double feature in 2 hours. That's nice. I think, yeah, like, you know, the, like, Atupusov, I don't know how to pronounce it, said, right? Most of the work was like parsing, like figuring out how to make it an, most of the work went into a flyhand use fewer import. Yeah, okay. Most of the work went into writing the parser because we got like these weird parsing, ambiguous parsing, right? And they're hard to fix. Because, like, we're not using parsec, right? Or mega parsec or any of those. So, it, like, it doesn't do backtracking, I think. I think that's the thing. So, it doesn't actually tell you, right? It doesn't tell you, I don't know which one to pick here. It just says ambiguous parse, right? So, it's just, like, it's as informative as saying, you know, segmentation fault core dropped, right? Doesn't tell you anything unless you already know what's wrong, kind of. Anyway, we didn't actually use read input. Let's do git status, and let's go back, use git, and let's move day 3 to day 3 and 4. Git add day 3 and 4. Right, and now I have to say we have to open this one in code because I changed the directory. No matter, it don't matter to me. Let's see. Oh yeah, let's make it bigger. I added a marked field, so Alex added a marked field to the table bool int, so that made figuring out the winning board very easy. Right. So you added a true or false for every time in every board that anything had been called. Is that Right, but like how long did it take, right? Because here we like, we just run a bunch of set differences, right? And the trick is that like we're not actually, like I think set differences can be computed super efficiently, right? Like m plus, you know, it's at like m times log n m blah blah, right? So it could do all the set differences right away. Which kind of end up being super fast. I mean, you could do this with like a bit mask or whatever. But, you know, 35 milliseconds is, that's pretty decent, right? I don't think that's, I think we should be happy with it, is what I'm trying to say. Boom. Let's see how long both take. Because like there's boot up time. Yeah, 255 milliseconds for both. Yes, I think we should be happy with how it went today. I mean, yeah. Apart from like stream issues, like the audio in the beginning, and that was very annoying. But it seems to be working now without. Yeah, I just like turned it off and on again a couple of times. Which makes sense. So let's look it over a bit, right? So yeah, here we have the filter. I mean, I don't really see any, like, I don't really see any, like, oh, this is something we could improve, right? There's no place where, like, oh, yeah, this is gonna take a long time, right? It's all just very straightforward. And I like that, you know, I like that with Haskell, especially, right? You can just write code and it's straightforward. And kind of, it does what you want, right? And it's pretty clear what you're doing. I think often in imperative code, there's so much overhead. Not in the execution, but in the like things you have to be doing that are not really related to the actual problem, right? Where like in, I guess, yeah, because I like Rust. I don't really program in Rust, but I it's a nice language. But like a lot of the code, like the character, like literal characters you're writing, are about memory management, right? You're always telling the computer how to allocate memory and who can borrow what, right? Which is, and that's, of course, I mean, it's important, right? If you want to execute fast, that it's all, the memory is all correct, right? But filling a bingo table is not about allocating memory, right? Here we're just talking about sets. And like, yeah. I mean, so we needed to parse, right? And that's like, yeah, okay. You just need to get it into a format that the computer can understand, right? But after that, we're just talking about like sets, which are like mathematical objects, right? You're not, you know, you don't have to allocate memory for the set. You don't have to say who can borrow this set, right? You're just using them. And then you allow the runtime system to decide if it's borrowable or not. I don't... Anyway, enough ranting about Rust. I should just learn Rust. And then I'll be... So first I have to learn Rust, and then I have to contribute to the compiler, right? Become a Rust person, Rustation, and then I can complain about Rust. That's how you do it. Yeah, exactly. So here we like built a bunch of small things, right? And then we just use task one again. And we're always just like, everything we do is just about like this small thing, we built it up and then we just use it. We're always just building up these pieces and puzzling them together. In Rust, you can't make a set of sets because sets don't implement hash. Right. And that's like one of the things, right? It's like, you know, it's not a part of the problem. Like, obviously you can have a set of sets, right? Mathematically, that makes sense, right? You can't have the set of all sets or set of sets that don't contain themselves, but you can have a set that contains a few sets, right? It's not related to the problem of sets, whether you can compute a hash or not. I mean, it's related to how we describe the computation, right? The computational problem, that's true, but it's not related to solving the problem, right? And that's how I like to do it, right? I want libraries and stuff like that, that kind of, they take care of, you know, how to describe, how to compute with the objects, right? And then you just kind of compose those. And in Haskell, that's a lot of what you do. Like, you define types, you define how they interact with each other, and all that jazz, right? There's nothing here saying how sets work, right? We just take set difference. We don't have to. Yeah. Anyway, and we're just composing functions, and yeah. So I really like Haskell. It's I think it's at the nice point in the abstraction cube or whatever. Like, you have to pick a point, right, where it's not too abstract, so you can actually get things done fast, right? And it's not too low level, so you can actually so you don't actually spend all your time spending how to manipulate pointers, right? Because pointers is not a pointer is not a thing in Bingo, right? You can view Bingo as a, you know, figuring out the subset of a set of sets, blah blah, like we did, right? And that's like a mathematical description of Bingo, right? You would never describe Bingo mathematically as a pointer to pointers, I think. So that's nice about Haskell, right? But for sure, as these challenges get harder and harder, they usually they also become very imperative, right? Because the author he came by actually last year. He's cool, but he's an imperative programmer, right? So all the kind of the sometimes the problems are kind of written with a certain solution in mind, and it's not a functional solution, right? So you end up having to do very imperative things to make it fast enough, which is also, and that's the thing about Haskell, right? You can also do that, right? You can have the like state transformers and vector arrays. You can even like describe how to do it concurrently and then just run it all in parallel without having to worry about allocating memory. But yeah, so we'll see. And yeah, and that's it's a lot of fun. But like, yeah, then like now we did two things in like an hour and a half, right? Or 2 hours and a half. But like, yeah, then, you know, you spend 2-3 hours on one task because you're manipulating state T. But anyway, thank you for stopping by today. Excel. So, and what I'm saying now, thank you for stopping by today. I'll be here tomorrow, like around this time. Meaning, I'm gonna stream at 7 o'clock European time, Central European time, Gothenburg time, which is like 6 o'clock UTC in Iceland, and then we'll see. We might have to get out into like proper mutation Haskell, right? And you can describe it in really nice ways, right? And that's the thing about Haskell, right? You can just go back to imperative stuff if you need to. But like in other languages, it's very hard usually to go to the into the functional direction, right? All right. See you tomorrow. Sorry for yesterday. But better to just do a double feature than miss out on nice things. And I'll make sure to test the sound better before tomorrow. I mean, it's working okay now, and it was working okay fine, but yeah. Make sure it works right before the stream. All right. Catch you all tomorrow. And all right. Bye-bye.